Yes, hello and welcome to a brand new show called Round Ball Rules. Every Wednesday coming your way on 10 Play. I'm Simon Hill. We thought we'd have a bit more of an in-depth chinwag about some of the issues that are surrounding the game of football here in Australia, both men's and women's. And to discuss issues, we need good football brains. And we've got them on the sofa with me. Georgia Yeoman-Dale, 5 times capped Matilda. Good to see you, Georgia.
Good to see you, Simon.
And Alex Brosque, 21 times capped Socceroo. Good to see you, Brosque, as well.
Simon.
We're going to get straight into it. We're going to talk about initially the Matildas, of course, Georgia, because they played these two friendly games against New Zealand, winning both. So on the surface, that's a good thing for Tony Gustafsson and his team. But you've been critical, fair to say, in the past about various things to do with the squad and the way it's been led. Have you been won over by these two friendly wins or not?
Look, to start with, it's great that they're back winning. It's been a rough 12 months, 18 months under Tony Gustafsson. They haven't won a lot of games. But I wouldn't say that I'm overly convinced after these two wins. It's against New Zealand, who we've dominated for the last 28 years. And in the first game, it took until the 95th minute before we scored. Yes, it was a dominant performance, but we're not scoring the goals that we need to be.
You think that's the big issue?
I think so. I think it's taking a hold of a game. I think we're creating chances. We created quite a few chances, but they're not burying the game early enough for me. We did see in the second game that they scored a few goals early on. But it's also, we're not seeing any squad rotation. We're not seeing a change in the starting 11. It was fantastic in these games to see Katrina Gorrie come back in and really prove her point of the fact that she's up to international football even after having a baby. She made a huge difference, and I think that it shows if we give more players an opportunity, they can come out and put on these performances.
Alex Chidiot was good too off the bench as well when she came on.
Fantastic. She was one of the standout players. She's a different kind of midfielder, very creative player. And to think that she wasn't even selected in his original squad for these two games is just unthinkable. And it was only because of the injury to Kyra Cooney-Cross that she actually got pulled in. So I have question marks over who's selecting his squads. If she wasn't initially in that group after the performance that she's had in the A-League Women's this season, who's making that call and
well,
not bringing
coaches,
her in?
Isn't it?
Well, I know that they have a selection panel, and he's spoken about it in the past, that there's lots of different people watching all the games, that he's not individually watching every single game. So I'm assuming that then there's a selection panel, but the fact that she wasn't picked up from the start raises a lot of questions for me.
Interesting. Selection panels for national teams. I haven't heard of that since Walter Winterbottom in England in the 1940s. Brosque, we're going to hear from Tony Gustafsson in just a moment. But in terms of the chances that the Matildas created, particularly in that first game, I think it was 37 or something like that in total. Is there a reason in your mind? I mean, you were a finisher back in your day playing. Is there a reason why they're not able to finish those chances?
Look, not really. And I think that's probably one area that we're being a little bit overly critical. I think it's more defensively that they have had issues over the past 12 months. I think scoring goals, you know, me personally, I don't think we need to be scoring 4, 5, 6 goals to win a game of football. You know, I think the 2 or 3 that they're getting seemingly every game at the moment should be enough. I think it is, you know, more pressing at the other end of the field, the concerns for Tony. But look, I think in a game like that where you're going to have chances, it's almost like a training game. You're going to have a lot of training, a lot of chances, create a lot of you know, chances in front of goal. You're not going to score all of them, you know. I think if you're having, how many did you say they had? About 30?
37, I think, in the first game.
Look, it is probably worrying, but in a one-off, they still scored 2. They scored 3 the following game. So the goals are still coming. It's probably a bit harsh to
expect.
But
when we look at their Asian Cup performance, for example, and getting knocked out against South Korea, they didn't take their chances there.
Them chances, that was the problem.
And then I think that's why we then criticise going into these games. Okay, well, you've created a lot of chances and you're not converting. And then that shows in games where you need to convert the few chances that you have that there is an issue.
Okay, well, obviously, Sam Kerr is one of the players who does convert chances. But if Sam Kerr's not available through injuries or loss of form, perish the thought, then what are the alternatives? Here's Tony Gustafsson's thoughts.
I think we have plenty of options in the 9. It depends a little bit on how we want to play. If you look at an M. Gilnick and a Remy. We have two players that can hit the space in behind the back line. In Asian Cup, we used Kaya as more of a false nine and a linky nine. And then you add Mary Fowler to the mix that could definitely play as a nine, as a linky nine. So we have different tools in there, depending on a little bit how we want to play.
Tony Gustafsson's thoughts on the central striking. You're smiling, Georgia. Come on, you're not convinced.
No, not convinced at all. I think that I agree with him and his statements of them being the options, but we haven't seen them. So how does he know how they're going to perform in this group at international level? Remy Simpson has had a handful of opportunities and it's been cameos off the bench. We haven't seen Em Gilnick since Tony Gustafsson's come in. I think she's had a few minutes.
And she's more of
minutes.
A wide player really anyway, isn't she, Emily Gilnick?
Exactly.
She can
play
there, of course.
So if you want her to be an option, you have to try her out in there. And I think that the big difference with the national team now compared to a few years ago is that there aren't as many games or training camps as they used to have. So when you get them together, you need to take that opportunity to try out these new combinations.
Okay. Well, that leads to our next point, which is about experimentation and whether Tony Gustafsson has done enough of it. Let's hear the coach's thoughts.
I was very open with that earlier on in this camp coming into it, that 21 was more of a year of experimentation. Even though we had tournaments and tough schedule, we looked at almost 75 players in high performance environment and then 14 debutants, which is not normal. And I know there might be some voices and opinion out there that we should keep experimenting, but if you look at it, the reality is we don't have many more games until the World Cup because we only have a few windows left in this year. And I can't say much more now, but I also know that there will be some player unavailability in some of those camps, which also one of the reasons why I had more continuity in the lineup in this camp. I'll tell you more closer to the June window.
Interesting, Brosque. Not giving too much away there, Tony Gustafsson. As we figure it out, there are three windows left before the FIFA Women's World Cup. One to come in June, there's one later on in the year, October, November time, and then one in January when I think there's a tournament planned. Mm-hmm. So theoretically, is there enough time for experimentation, or is that time passed in your opinion?
Look, I think with what he's saying there and given the amount of windows there are, there probably isn't in reality. I think you're probably looking at two then, the one in June, which going off his comments there, he probably won't have a large number of the girls available, whether that's due to getting some rest or other reasons. So there probably will be a window where he can experiment a little bit. But yeah, other than that, then you've got the October window, and then January is when you want to get started with the preparation leading into the World Cup. So look, he's probably, probably need to cut him a little bit of slack, probably more now. There's not much time to go, but he has had the time to do it in the past. Mm. So he won't have any excuses moving forward from now.
Georgia, some of the solutions that he found in this mini-series was, Katrina Gorry, that you've already alluded to, was very, very good in that number six position. Has she sort of cemented her place in that position, do you think? And also, I'm intrigued to your thoughts on the goalkeeping situation. Lydia Williams started both matches. Has she now got the jump on Mackenzie Arnold and Tegan Micah as his first pick?
Yeah, so starting with Katrina Gorry, I think she's had a fantastic couple of games there. I think probably the most effective of the players that we've seen in the last 18 months. Closely followed by Claire Wheeler, who also hasn't had a whole lot of opportunity, but when she has, she's really nailed that position. But it's great to see Katrina Gorry back in the squad. I think that they'll really need her. To Lydia Williams, it seems that she is his number one pick. I mean, she has a lot of experience in going into a World Cup, probably her last World Cup. You know that she's capable of playing in big tournaments, even though we did see Tegan Micah through most of the Olympic Games, and I thought she was a standout player in that group. So I think the competition really is between the two of those. Mackenzie Arnold, I think, is taking the back seat a little bit. She has had a couple of howlers in the chances that she's had. So it seems that Tony Gustafsson's definitely going for that Lydia Williams.
The interesting thing for me with Mackenzie Arnold, out of the three goalkeepers, she's probably the one that's playing the most regularly, and she's playing very consistently well for a club side, West Ham United, in the FA Women's Super League as well. Lydia Williams starts mainly on the bench for Arsenal. Tegan Micah, I know she does start for a club side in Scandinavia, but I think they're out of season at the moment. I might be wrong on that.
Yeah. I think they're coming back in now.
Is there a reason why Mackenzie Arnold hasn't been able to take her opportunity?
I don't know why. I agree with you. I think she's having some great club level appearances and in great form there. But every time she comes into the national team, it's I don't know if it's a brain snap or if it's the pressure of it, and remembering the mistakes that she's made in previous national team games, if that's really thrown her and her confidence. But I mean, you've played more national team games than me. What do you think?
Look, not many more, but I think you're right. I think sometimes it can be as good as, like, they're two totally different things. So you can be in a certain, you know, way of form for your club and then go to the national team and that all disappears, you know, for some people anyway. Obviously, it seems in this case like it may be playing some sort of role mentally. I wonder if, you know, the coaches have sat down with her, had that chat. I'm sure they would have. But, look, that can definitely be the case. You know, you incredible form in your club, go to the national team, and it's just a different pressure altogether.
One final quick one on the Matildas, because we have to talk about the A-League men's competition. But I just want a quick thought on the Ali Green situation. She's nominated for New Zealand. She was in the squad for these two games against the Matildas. Didn't play because I don't think the clearance has come through. Should she have had an opportunity, in your opinion?
I think she should have. I think she should have at least got called into a camp. And that's based off, you look at the benchmark that he's set for that next player coming in to fill in the shoes of Steph Catley. I don't think she's up to the Steph Catley benchmark, and I don't think anyone's making claims that she is. But if you've got Courtney Nevin in your squad and that's your benchmark, I think Ali Green definitely should have been given an opportunity to be in there. I think she's a big loss for Australia and a very big gain for New Zealand.
Okay, great stuff. Brosque, fire up. It's time to talk about the A-League men's. And in particular, we're going to start off with Sydney FC. What on earth went on with the Sky Blues against Adelaide United? And are their finals hopes now all but gone? Or is that too premature?
I think they are all gone. Look, I think speaking honestly, if you look at the quality that they have, again, you're down to looking at the numbers now, at whether they, you know, have enough wins in them with the games they have left to make scrape into the six. And look, that's an issue in itself, but I just simply don't think with 37 points, if they do win their last two games, it'll be enough. I think they, you know, this was a game that they had to win, and they looked for, you know, 80 something odd minutes like they would win. But inconsistency and just that ability to find a way to kill teams off and win games that has plagued them all season came back to bite them again. And on the other side, Adelaide's ability to just find late equalisers, late winners, is what kept them in the hunt for a top six place. So, look, Sydney, I think, unfortunately, you know, where they deserve to be at the moment, given the season they've had. And yeah, look, I think their season is pretty much done.
Let's ask you the hard question. Is it time for a revamp if they don't make the finals? Is it time for a revamp anyway at Sydney FC?
I think given the season that they have, it is, questions need to start being asked, and that's rightfully so. It right through from the coach down to the players, down to everything. I mean, when a team like Sydney doesn't make the finals, you know, alarm bells need to be ringing, I think, you know. So everything needs to get looked at. In saying that, Corica, with what he's done in the three seasons he's been in charge, has been incredible. So if there's a coach that's earned at least a chance to, you know, get the team back into form and rebuild the squad, that's him. I think he's earned himself that chance for next season, which I'm sure he will get. And then it's just down to personnel, you know, which of those older players are going to be staying on, and the recruitment for next year. I mean, that has to, I'd imagine, already have been in place.
Did he get it wrong this year, do you think?
Well, it's easy to sit back now and look at it. Yeah, I think not that he got it wrong. It's that it just, things didn't work. You know, you'd expect Bobo to get you, you know, 15 to 20 goals. You'd expect Lafondra to do the same thing. And neither of them scored more than, you know, 5 or 6 goals to this point. So that's where the issue is for Sydney. They weren't able to score the goals that they should have scored. They weren't able to kill teams off, like I said before. It's not a full revamp that they need, but, you know, recruitment will be very, very important for next year for them.
The one thing that stands out to me when you look at that ladder, George, and it's the same in the A-League Women's as well, with Melbourne Victory winning the title again, is a Victorian takeover. What's happened to New South Wales?
Yeah, it seems to be falling off. But what I love about that ladder is how many teams are competing for that final push at the bottom of the top six, I suppose.
Well, let's talk about, I mean, we're arguing just backstage about who we think each of us is actually going to make it, and we're on completely different wavelengths. Georgia seems to think that the Jets and the Mariners could make a bit of a push. I think the Jets and the Mariners, or the Jets more so, are just given the points they need. They need to win four games to get to that 38 mark, four games out of their last six. Achievable given the squad they have, but you know, same with the Mariners, same with MacArthur, but given how inconsistent every one of those clubs have been, it's just hard to see.
Well, that's the A-League in general, isn't it? Inconsistency rules, highlighted by the fact that Wellington Phoenix copped five and then six on the jaw and then went to Western United and won 4-1 away from home. And there's no rhyme nor reason to all of this. I know you're a big fan of Ufuk Tale Broski as a coach. If Wellington make the finals, given everything that they've been through this season, would that be one of their finest achievements yet, do you think?
I think it would have to be, but also highlight how good a manager Ufi is, because you know, for the past two seasons, they've barely been at home. I think they played one or two games in Wellington. Otherwise, they've been all over, you know, the eastern coast of Australia, playing games all over the place. So I think given those struggles, the players being away from their families, for them to be in contention and I think with a real decent run home to play in finals football this year, he's done an incredible job, and it will be a highlight, I think, in Wellington's history.
They've got a couple of home games to come, of course, as well, George. They play Perth away from home tonight, but after that, then they go back to New Zealand. They can really feed off that emotion of a home crowd after so long away as well, which might help them in their finals push.
Yeah, and especially at this stage in the season where, you know, fatigue can start to set in. It's been a big push for a lot of teams over the last little bit, a lot of games in a row, and to be able to go back home, do it in front of a home crowd, I think is going to be a great finish for them.
And we saw it last year when they did play that first game back in Wellington. The crowd was insane. And I think Wellington, on a normal sort of week, is a difficult place to go and play. When you've got a crowd like that, it'll really give them the boost, yeah.
Now, I want to ask you both, and I'll start with you, Georgia, on this one. Western United, who were on the other end of that scoreline, losing to Wellington Phoenix 4-1, the early part of the season for them was characterised by a very strong defence. You're a defender back in the day. What's happened to them? Because all of a sudden they're copping goals left, right and centre. Now, we know we saw in the early part of the season the XG that we talk a lot about on template was saying that they should have conceded more goals than they were actually conceded. Now it seems as though they've gone back almost to normal. Is there a reason for it? Are they attacking a bit more? Are they looser defensively? Is it confidence? Is it focus? What is it?
Yeah, look, I think at the start of the season, as you mentioned, they weren't conceding a lot of goals. And for a lot of other teams coming up against them, that's hard to know that you're playing against a team that has a very tight defence that, you know, that teams struggle to break down. So it's a mental thing on the opposition. Once teams start getting that flow on, you know, you can start to see how to break a team down. And I think that more analysis has gone in for other teams on how to break them down. And then they're struggling, I think, as a defensive unit to then deal with that. Because early in the season, they didn't have to come back from, you know, a few goals down. They didn't
one
need to
enough.
Claw them their way back in. It was just shut the gates and we'll score one on a counter-attack.
You've got a different theory, Broski, I think.
Sort of. Look, I think the fact that they are... Look, Johnny probably did look at that and say, well, hold on, you know, yes, we are winning a lot of games 1-0, but like the expected goals shows, we probably got a little bit lucky a few times there. So one's not going to be enough. I feel like they are focusing a bit more on their attack, on creating more chances, because before we watched a lot of games, it was very much a counter-attack style game, you know, with Connor Payne, Lockie Wales running in behind and trying to create chances, but it wasn't very many that they were getting. I wonder if Johnny's just realised that won't be enough when you go into the finals. They focus more on attack, and that just naturally opens them up a little bit more to, you know, conceding a few more chances, and then the goals that they probably should have been conceding, they now are.
But then defensively, they were absolutely shocking against Wellington the other day. It wasn't even necessarily Wellington playing well, but there was no midfield tracking from Western United, and it seemed like they just struggled to defend against that counter-attack. And maybe it is, you're right, they're throwing so many players forward and they haven't got the legs then to get back.
I think more recently anyway, like, we've seen some massive scorelines. I just think the amount of games that teams are playing at the moment is really hurting them.
That
fatigue
might be a part
is
of it.
Really setting in. So that 4-1, we can probably just take as a one-off. But, I mean, in general, yes, they've been conceding more than they were. But every team, you've seen 5-0, 6-0, 4-1. It's been a crazy couple of weeks.
Which is a lovely segue to our next little talking point, which surrounds the Central Coast Mariners, for whom the wheels really did come off against Sydney FC. Although, in fairness, I don't think it was a 5-0 game. They were still in it up until the 50th minute, and then Sydney scored three or four in the space of a few-minute spell. There is a lot of talk at the moment about some off-field problems for the Central Coast Mariners, in particular surrounding Oli Bozanic, whether he's in dispute with the club, whether he's fallen out with the coach. Does that have the potential, Brosque, to derail their finals campaign? They play the Wanderers, of course, away tonight at CommBank Stadium.
Look, I think given how important he is amongst the playing group and to the club as a whole, it definitely can. I think it's an unfortunate situation. And having been there in that Sydney game, you hear a few whispers about what the reason is. We came here today and are talking about a few other things. So, look, I think it's a disappointing situation, especially with a player like him. And hard to see how it wouldn't have an effect. I mean, someone with a voice and a presence like he has in that change room, just sitting there and not able to play at the moment, you'd have to think that it's playing some sort of role. I don't think that's the reason why they lost, 5-0 against Sydney. They've been in quite good form heading into that game. But heading into the finals, definitely a distraction they don't need.
Perth have got some distractions as well, Georgia, off the pitch. It looks like they're going to win, if that's the right term, their first ever wooden spoon, which is a real disappointment for a famous club that's been going for 25 years in both the NSL and now the A-League, of course. But Tony Sage went on Facebook, the club owner, yesterday and had a crack at some of the keyboard warriors who are attacking the club at the moment. But it's understandable, isn't it? The club are bottom of the table. And yes, they've had a lot of problems off the pitch. Is there a way back for them? Maybe not this season.
No, I think it's understandable to start with. There was so much promise around the club at the start of the season. Huge signing in Sturridge, and we haven't seen him. So you can imagine for the Perth Glory fans, they're disappointed in the club, and they're used to seeing them perform better than this, get better results than this. I think that, it's the first time that Perth Glory have had not had that advantage of home games and teams having to travel from the east over to the west, which is a huge ask. But aside from that, there's so many issues within the group and obvious issues off-field as well.
Terry McFlynn has gone as well, of course.
He is. I spoke to him not long after it happened. And look, I think that sort of, in a way, just sums up the issues that they're having. Right. I mean, from the player recruitment, I think they lost a lot of players from last season and didn't recruit well enough to give Garcia a chance to even challenge for anything this year. I thought they would finish 10th, 11th or 12th, which is exactly where they are. I didn't think they'd necessarily get the spoon and be as bad as they were. I still thought they had enough quality. And then in getting rid of Richie, bringing in Ruben, who, I haven't seen much of what he's been doing from a managerial point of view, but he's still young, he's still learning, So I think they need to get that side right moving into next season. They need to bring in someone that's going to be able to, have some player pulling power to bring in the players to turn that club around. You're right, it's a shambles at the moment. Perth Glory, as big as that club is, to be bottom of the table, should not be happening. I think the fans have every right to be upset. I don't necessarily agree with Tony Sage getting involved in, social media battles and calling out his own fans. I don't have social media, so that could just me be being a dinosaur, so to speak. But I don't like that whole thing, interacting with them, and especially in a negative way. I think he should do what he has to do, which is focus on getting this club back to where they should be.
Well, strangely enough, Tony Popovich, former Perth Glory coach, of course, is certainly trying to get Melbourne Victory back to where they think they should be. And they're on the right track, although they did stumble a little bit against Brisbane Roar in a goalless draw midweek. Prior to that, they won the Melbourne Derby. How good is Marco Rojas at the moment? He is really back to his best, Georgia.
He is in great form. He's such an exciting player. When he gets the ball at his feet, he's always creating opportunities. And this was just a fantastic goal. I think in this game, though, they dominated for that half an hour period. Glover had a few absolute honkers, which he would love to forget, and setting up that one for Rojas when he came out and punched. But it was a great victory performance for that 30 minutes.
It was. Look, I think it's again, one of those games. We have been seeing high-scoring matches at the moment. But for City, it was just a strange one. We didn't expect it. The form that they've been in, that's a big derby. To lose 3-0 is a statement win from Melbourne Victory. Somewhat concerning, I think, for City, given the fact that it was such a big game and a derby. But look, I think both managers have been excellent. Popper's been doing a great job in turning that club around. Paddy Kisnorbo as well at Melbourne City. So look, I don't think too much can be taken from it. But Rojas has been, he's one of those players that you just love watching. When he's in this sort of form, which leading into the finals is great, you pay money to see these guys because they do things that others can't. They score wonderful goals, they dribble, he's direct, he's exciting. And hopefully he stays in his form.
Okay, and I'm going to use the word honkers in commentary in the coming weeks. Talking of which, Georgia, how about this for a honker? Daniel Margush at the weekend. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Yeah, well, it wasn't good. And I'm not sure he would want to watch the footage back. I don't know what he's trying to do there. You know, gets it all mixed under his feet and then goes for a rugby tackle. It's shocking.
You know, every time the ball gets played back to a goalkeeper, I don't know if it's just me, but my heart stops just for that little second, just thinking, oh, just please don't get in a situation like that. And when you see it, I still start sweating even just looking about it, feeling sorry for him. But yeah, it was unfortunate. What do you do? I mean, it's obviously not the first time it's happened to them, and Rudin's reaction was a great one. But
I just want to say on a serious note, goalkeepers, obviously, they're not used to, you know, playing the whole game with their feet. When the ball goes back to them in that sort of situation, you'd imagine maybe if it's a defender and they get it sort of stuck between their feet, they just backheel it out of play, Take the safe option. But a goalkeeper's instinct is not really to do that, is it?
Yeah, well, watching it live, I was like, surely he's just going to concede. Just take the corner and just try defend it. But you might be right. Maybe it's just he's got it in his head. Yeah. I need to clear this, and that a corner is just as dangerous.
Look, we've all had moments like that where you just have a shocking touch, yeah, like near the sideline and it goes out.
Unfortunately, with a goalkeeper, it costs you a goal.
Exactly
normally,
right, which is why it makes you so nervous every time a ball gets played. But, look, again, it's hard to watch. You feel bad for him, but you'll spend another week thinking about it.
Given, of course, as you alluded to, Brosque, veteran Jan Jetovic did something very similar, strangely enough, against Brisbane a few years ago. Touching the ball before it was about to go out for a goal kick, and Brisbane ended up equalising from the resultant corner. There's some problem, isn't there, the Wanderers with this particular game?
The weird thing about that one is that I think it was a long ball, so if he sort of let it run out, he could have just taken a goal kick. Yeah. For him to even think about, I mean, it's a complete brain snap at the end of the day. There's nothing you can do about it, but just another, yeah, you're right, the Wanderers have had to sit through a couple of these now.
Yeah. Our apologies to both veteran Jan Jetovic and Daniel Margush for bringing those up. But it is a talking point. That's what we are here to do on Round Ball Rules. We're going to head off to a quick break. On the other side of it, we will assess the Asian Champions League hopes for Melbourne City and Sydney FC. Back soon. Yes, welcome back to Round Ball Rules, part two. We're going to look ahead to the Asian Champions League with two Australian teams involved, of course, Melbourne City and Sydney FC. We've only had one team qualify for the knockout phase since 2016, Georgie Yeoman-Dale and Alex Brosque. So can one of our two teams, or hopefully both, do it this time? Georgia, Melbourne City, they're up against BG Partum United, Jeonnam Dragons and United City of the Philippines. I'm going to go in early and say that if Melbourne City don't win that group, then they shouldn't be in the Champions League. I think they should finish top.
That's a big call, Simon.
I'm prepared to stick by it.
I think they've definitely got a winnable group. I think when you look at they've got a deep squad, but when you look at the players that they've lost going into this Champions League, two of their main midfielders, that changes things up a little bit. But I think you're right. I think it's a very manageable group for them.
Berengay and Aidan O'Neill are the two that are out, but they've got enough depth to cover, haven't they, Brosque?
Oh, definitely. Look, I mean, when you've got Tilio that's coming off the bench, who's now a Socceroo, you know, that's a huge luxury that Paddy Kiznaiba has. So you're right. You're looking at the group that they have, you know, even the one you expect to be probably the most, Jeonnam Dragons from Korea. They're playing in the second division, generally a mid-table club. So, I don't see anyone that can really give Melbourne City much of a run in this group, and you're right, I think they should top it.
But we talk about the group, yep, the depth in that squad, and when you're playing games every 2 or 3 days, you need that depth just to get through the games. They've lost a few of their players. I think that,
well, I think more potentially, so
as you go through the group.
Exactly right. In the next phase, that's where, you know, if these two are still missing, that will be an issue. But to get out of the group, I don't think it will be a concern for them.
I actually think their biggest threat in this group is BG Putnam United, A, because they'll be playing in home conditions in Thailand, but also the fact that they've got a bit of Champions League experience. They got through to the round of 16 the last time in 2021, when, of course, Australian clubs were missing from the tournament, and only lost to Jeonbuk Motors on penalties. They're a sort of a rising force, and Thai football in general is on the move. In fact, Southeast Asia in general, but particular Thailand and Vietnam. United City, the most ambiguously named football club in Asia. Let's be honest. Who's going to cheer for that, Brosque?
Look, given their second name is City, maybe you. That's about it.
Well, they used to be Ceres Negros, which Brisbane Roar fans, sorry if you've just broken out in a cold sweat at hearing that name. But they haven't played a league game, I don't think, in the best part of 2 years, because their domestic campaign was cancelled due to COVID in 2020. They didn't play last year, so they're going to be pretty short of a gallop, aren't they?
Yeah, an unknown entity that could play into their hands. But yeah, I think not coming in with a whole lot of competitive games under your belt is going to be a challenge.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. Let's talk about Sydney FC. They're in a group that involves Jeonbuk Motors and also Hoang An Gia Lai of Vietnam. They will be the host team, and intriguingly, Brosque, Yokohama F. Marinos, led, of course, by Kevin Muscat.
Yeah, I mean, Kevin Muscat probably thought he'd seen Sydney FC for the last time a few years ago, and here they are again. So I think I can't wait for that battle. I think it's going to be, given, I think, what he's doing at the moment with them. Look, Kawasaki have had a brilliant couple of years and really, you know, won the J-League by, you know, many points over the last couple of seasons. This is the first year, I think, that they probably will come down a little bit closer to the pack, and you know, Muskie's Marinos will be there to push them the whole way. So there's a lot being said about them. They're playing good football. They're second at the moment. And look, them along with Jeonbuk, I think, will be Sydney's biggest dangers in this group.
It's a tough group. They played Sydney, Yokohama F. Marinos, Georgia in 2020, in the days of Ange Postecoglou, and I remember calling that game. Sydney got absolutely smashed by 4-0. Yokohama were on a completely different level. As a footballer, when you play against a team, particularly, you know, when you've played them before and been hammered, does that play in your mind, or is it completely new? New team, new environment, new season, doesn't matter.
I think for the players who were around in that time, yes, I think it will play on their mind. And I think we also look at the form that Sydney FC were in when they did get smashed last time. They were, you know, dominating the A-League. This season, they're struggling to make the top six, and you're coming up against them again in very different form.
But I think that's generally, for whatever reason, teams doing well in the A-League go on to struggle in the Champions League. Teams struggling in the A-League go on to somehow do well. So it could be, they could be thinking about it that way. But if
is
not,
that just you and a Sydney FC
no,
thing?
No,
you're
no,
just
I'm thinking
sitting
in general.
Fingers crossed.
I mean, Brisbane Roar, when they were flying under Ange, they went, everyone thought they'd do amazing in the Champions League, and they didn't get out of the group, I don't think. So it's just a weird way that it sort of works. It's almost like you sort of leave your troubles behind or whatever's happening in the A-League, go and focus on that, and it just, things work differently. But with what you're saying about Yokohama Marinos, I think it's more every time we face a Japanese team in general, it felt like there were 15 of them, and we're just chasing shadows all the time. So I don't think they'll be looking at that last game in general. It'll just be that it's another Japanese team.
Yeah.
You know, and they're always difficult.
It is a very tough group for Sydney FC. Jeonbuk Motors, twice winners of this competition, 2006 and again 10 years later. And Hoang An Gia Lai, the outsider in the group, but led by the legendary Kiatasak Sinamawang. You might remember him from the Asian Cup in 2007 and the Thai national team. And of course, they will have home advantage. So again, maybe a puncher's chance because of being familiar with home conditions. Do you fancy that Sydney can get through? I must admit, I think they're going to struggle. I think they'll finish third in this group, but that's only me.
No, I agree. I think that they're really going to struggle to get out of this one for the reasons that you say, coming up against a Japanese side, big struggle, especially when it is the likes of Yokohama and then Jeonbuk as well. It's a Korean side that's dominated their league for so long, and I think that you're right, they're going to be coming third, if not fourth, but in
Brosque,
that group.
Give Sydney fans well, you some need hope. A Come on.
Look, I think they've got a chance, definitely. I think, they, like I said before, they'll probably be happy to get out of Australia, forget everything that's happening in the A-League, and just turn their focus and you know, with the quality that they have, at the end of the day, it's an incredible squad. They have it in them to, and the fact that they're not travelling, you know, to Japan, to Korea and back, and having to worry about that, it's just in the one location, six games. They've got good depth within the squad. I think, look, they have a chance. I don't know if they'll top the group, but I think they can squeeze in to that top two somehow.
Well, the Australian games on 10 play, and every fixture of the Asian Champions League this season, for the very first time ever, you'll be able to watch every single game, East and West, on Paramount Plus, which is absolutely fantastic. Before we go, guys, I want to ask you just a general question. I don't know if you saw this last week. The Asian Super League is apparently in the offing. We're having discussions about it. Australia involved in those discussions as part of the Eastern region. Is that the way forward? They're talking about increased prize money, but elite nations only. Is that the way forward for the AFC to exclude the likes of Laos and Cambodia and Uzbekistan and just go with the elite level, albeit more money involved potentially for our clubs?
Look, I don't like it. We spoke about it last week, and it didn't work for Europe. We saw the uproar that was caused just by even mentioning that it was going to happen.
But Asia's a bit different, isn't it?
It's different.
Is this a way for us to lift standards in our region? And ultimately, I assume that they'll be looking at something similar for the women as well. Got to get a Champions League first for the women, at least to start. But
look, I think I like the increased prize money, but why can't we just do that with the current format? Mm. You know, I think with increased prize money, it generates clubs trying more, I think. You know, we've seen it within the A-League that within two, three games, if they're not in it with much of a chance, the focus is gone. I think teams will devote a lot more energy, resources, and wanting to actually win the competition if the prize money is there. So I just think under the current model, with better prize money, it could work anyway. I don't think it needs to be an elite sort of club thing only.
Georgia, you get the final word.
Yeah, I agree with Brosque. I think that you cut your market. I think, like, why don't we have everyone there? You're buying into it and you're giving everyone a chance to be there. I don't think that we need to come out and be supreme to anyone else across Asia.
Well, okay. Giving everyone the chance, I mean, exactly right. You don't earn the right to be there just by the amount of money or how big your club is. I mean, you earn it by the position you finish in the league, and I think you take away giving every club in every league in Asia the chance to participate in this tournament.
Earn is the key word, though, as we all know in football these days. It'll all probably come down to money in the end. That is it for our inaugural edition of Round Ball Rules. Thank you very much to Georgia Yeoman-Dale and to Alex Brosque. Good to have your company and for your company too. And we will see you next week on Round Ball Rules. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for coming. See you then.